So, at the risk of this thing pissing them off, I'm going to remove it. due to the risk. Use a little black table instead. Well, good view. It looks like they're a little less pissed off. What's up, Maximo? How's it going? Anybody just joining us, feel free to sign in on the chat. Ask any questions you feel like. Even related to other things. I'll probably put the news on here shortly. Although, if anyone's been following my Twitter account, I got some sleep to catch up on. Brown rose bubble here has the white spots on it. I'm pretty sure that's a good thing. That's a extremely active steam, so definitely doing the bubbly thing. Hi, Lacey. So I am as tired as a set of Michelins on a NASCAR. Oh, it's a pun. I know. It's okay, Bubbles. The camera's not a fish. It's not going to eat your eggs. Former Defense Secretary William Cohen.
I've never seen to sort of out crazy a crazy leader in North Korea.
Not a chance. This is just impulsive, ill thought out action that is unlikely to do anything but move us more toward a confrontation. This was not written by the National Security Council, H.R. McMaster. This is right off the top of his head in his hotel.
That is General Barry McCaffrey yesterday with Nicole, and just moments ago, Secretary of State Rex Tillerson landed in Guam on a scheduled refueling stop on the way back home. And despite some hot rhetoric from North Korea in response to President Trump, Secretary Tillerson said there is, quote, no imminent threat, and he told reporters this.
I think Americans should sleep well at night and have no concerns about this particular rhetoric of the last few days. I think the president, again, as commander-in-chief, I think he felt it necessary to issue a very strong statement directly to North Korea. But I think what the president was just reaffirming is the United States has the capability to fully defend itself from any attack and defend our allies, and we will do so. And so the American people should sleep well at night.
Secretary Tillerson talking about the now specific threat against Guam from North Korea. Joining us now, ranking member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, Senator Ben Cardin of Maryland, and Washington former Secretary. questions for you, starting with Joe.
Hey, Mr. Secretary, let's begin with you. You have obviously been immersed in this issue for quite some time. Barack Obama had told Donald Trump during the transition that North Korea was going to be one of his biggest problems, but this is a problem you were dealing with back in the 90s. Tell us what's happened and what we can expect moving forward.
Well, the North Koreans have simply accelerated their development and their goal to develop a nuclear capability, one that can threaten the United States. But they are not suicidal, and this is the message that the president has sent, or should send in a way that doesn't sound, and I have to hyphenate the word, bombastic. That kind of language is not going to intimidate the North Koreans. To me, it's always better if you see an enemy that remains silent, that's more frightening than someone who is beating his chest or engaging in schoolyard banter or locker room language and to have a more powerful impact. So I think silence would have been very good here, and let the diplomats like Secretary Tillerson and the others who are trying to bring about a peaceful solution to this have the authority to do so. And simply issuing threats, which the North Koreans are not going to take as serious, because they know intuitively, I think, that the United States is not going to launch a preemptive attack, putting at risk hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of South Koreans and Japanese and others. So I think we have to be careful of the rhetoric. It doesn't push us closer, but I think it's pretty bombastic.
Mr. Secretary, if you can expand a little bit on your comments that North Korea is not suicidal. We in the West try to paint them as irrational, possibly suicidal, crazy. In fact, from their point of view, looking at what happened with Libya and Muammar Gaddafi when he gave up his weapons program, many believe that the North Koreans think the most suicidal approach would be not to develop nuclear weapons and be exposed to possibly having their regime overthrown. They see that as their protection against what happened to Gaddafi in Libya.
Well, to go back to the Chinese strategy, Sun Tzu, he said, you must know your enemy, and to know your enemy, you must think like your enemy. I think we have to do more of that to understand what their goal is. Their goal is not to invite a nuclear holocaust. Their goal is to remain secure in perpetuity with the family, if they can, to develop their country, and hopefully they think one day to dominate the Korean Peninsula, whether by intimidation or by some sort of an agreement which takes down the barriers, where you can have a united Korea that is not militarized. Now, that may be pie in the sky, but they are not taking action to invite an attack by the United States. That is totally counterintuitive, certainly from our point, and I believe from theirs.
Senator Cardin, you were very critical of President Trump's comment yesterday, the fire and fury comment. You said they were not helpful. They show he lacked the temperament, you say, and judgment to deal with the serious crisis the United States confronts. Excuse me. What is your specific concern as it relates not to the president's temperament, but what it means for foreign policy and for the United States and national security?
Well, I think the international community is looking to the United States for leadership to avoid a military confrontation with North Korea that could well involve nuclear weapons. And what the president said was just not helpful, but also raises the question to the international community whether the United States has a game plan for North Korea in order to change the equations. So I think it was just the wrong message and elevated the situation rather than showing the international community that there is hope for a diplomatic solution.
Now, Senator, a familiar refrain that there are no good options when it comes to North Korea at this point, given what you've said, given the new rhetoric, and also the tests we've seen and the reports from NBC News that the North Korea does now have nuclear capability that can be attached to an ICBM. What is the best course of action for the United States right now?
I think the best course of action is continue to work with the international community to change the equation, particularly for China, so China becomes much more engaged in working to get North Korea to at least freeze their program, to sit down and talk, to show that there's a path forward. And I agree with the Secretary. I think what the North Koreans want is to preserve their regime. China also wants to preserve that type of regime in North Korea. So we should have a common agenda with China to ease back on the current situation in North Korea.
David Ignatius. I want to ask Secretary Cohen, Secretary, without divulging things that were classified, give us a sense. We always talk about how bad the military options are in dealing with North Korea. You look carefully at this. Give us a sense of the options and why they trouble people who look at them.
Well, as we know, that the North Koreans have as many as 15,000-20,000 artillery capability about 40 miles, 45 miles from downtown Seoul. They could rain Seoul with these missiles and destroy it in a matter of a few hours or days if necessary. They also have nuclear weapons, which are buried deep in their territory, hard to detect, hard to get at. So the notion that we would launch a preemptive attack, thinking that we could wipe them out before they could strike, I think is foolhardy. And that is one of the reasons why the military commanders have never, in my judgment, ever advocated that we take a preemptive military strike against the North Koreans. If we're trying to send a signal to the Chinese and to others, what we ought to do is call the South Korean President, Moon, and say, put the THAAD missile system back on track. You suspended it. Put it back on track. That gives you some defensive capability. Go to the Japanese and say, perhaps it's time for you to have the THAAD system there as well. Start doing those things in conjunction with the sanctions that have just been voted upon, and start squeezing the North Koreans and saying, it's going to get tougher for you. We're going to make it very hard for you to be able to continue this testing and having the resources to do it. And then maybe they'll be in a mood at that point, with the help of the Chinese and the Russians, say, let's get back to the table so we can solve this. Because the United States should be determined to squeeze like a python the North Koreans and saying, we're going to continue this on a non-military basis, but make it very painful for you to continue what you're doing. I think the notion that the military is now accelerating their planning for a military attack, we've always had plans for what if. What if we have to go first? What if we have to respond? So that's not something new. And I think Secretary Tillerson's comments are just the right ones. Let's take a deep breath. Let's rest easy at night. We have a capability of deterrence and destructive capability second to none. We don't have to worry to the point where it becomes hysterical or what the next move is by them or what we're going to say in response to what they're doing.
Senator Cardin, Andrea Mitchell's initial reporting earlier this morning indicates that Defense, the NSC, as well as the Chief of Staff, had very little
Andrea. Any
into the President's statement issued yesterday. So that leaves three generals with the knowledge of the military, knowledge of foreign affairs, sort of out of the loop, according to this reporting. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think this is how President Trump operates, and I think it's very unfortunate. It's not the way you should be conducting foreign policy. As Secretary Cohen said, there's not really a good military option here. The best option is to continue a process in which we isolate North Korea and change the equations, particularly for China and Russia, to help us to avoid this type of a military confrontation. That's our best strategy. And what the president is doing by making his own unilateral decisions that indicate that we're ready to start a military confrontation, that's just moving in the wrong direction to get the type of international response we need to get North Korea to freeze their program and sit down and negotiate a peaceful end to this nuclear confrontation.
Senator Ben Cardin, ranking member of Foreign Relations, and former Defense Secretary William Cohen, great to have both your perspectives this morning. Thanks so much. Still ahead, President Trump is no fan of what he calls fake news, which is often reporting about his struggles in the White House. But a new report says he gets some good news as well, a so-called propaganda document of glowing stories. We'll dig into that when we come right back.
Thanks for checking out MSNBC on YouTube, and make sure you subscribe to stay up to date on the day's biggest stories. And you can click on any of the videos around us to watch more from Morning Joe and MSNBC. Thanks so much for watching.
Okay, ferret shows human her babies. I have to see that. Oh, yeah. Just a minute long.
biting and pulling his hand. Okay, that's pretty cute. Y'all search for the video Ferret Shows Human Her Babies. That's pretty cute. I used to have a ferret. It was my my first stepdad's. His name was Shithead. Oh, what a lovely life I lived.
Inside North Korea more than a dozen times, or is this line the very latest information?
Oh, so now they're showing graphics of AM Joy, and they're showing CNN video. Not just the live broadcast showing MSNBC stuff, and then you replace CNN. Now they're doing it with the video. Let the raids begin. The only way to get the cockroaches out.
Special counsel's probe as well that's ongoing.
And, you know, of most focus, or perhaps most focus at this point, is the fact that just a few weeks ago, it was disclosed that Paul Manafort did in fact meet with that Russian lawyer in that meeting that was initiated in part by Donald Trump Jr. So, of course, that has become a focus. We know that Paul Manafort did take some handwritten notes. I believe that they've been handed over to at least the congressional committees. So, again, there's renewed focus on Paul Manafort, his role in that meeting, and what else he may have known about that meeting, or what he might be able to disclose about that meeting. And, of course, also the timeline is interesting here. This raid, according to the Washington Post, happened on July 26th. This was right as those congressional probes and the hearings were ramping up. It was expected that Paul Manafort might be meeting with the Senate Judiciary Committee on July 26th. Of course, we know that didn't happen. They decided not to issue a subpoena for Paul Manafort because he agreed to more fully cooperate with them. So, yes, Paul Manafort, we know, according to his spokesman, has been cooperating with the congressional committee. But the question is, Special Counsel Mueller's probe, that is a completely different track, perhaps different focuses. So they might not be getting exactly what they want. That's why this raid is necessary. It's important to note, look, I mean, you even had the Republican chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee, Chuck Grassley, Jessica, they're saying we're going to compel him to testify in public, subpoena him if he does not cooperate more. And then, of course, they got some agreement, came behind closed doors, and then the raid happened 4 hours later. Thank you, Jessica.
Wow. 4 hours after his testimony, the FBI raided him. 4 hours after his testimony.
Thank you, allergy pills.
Exploring a fresh attack on the president's chief strategist, Steve Bannon, and from an unexpected place, the Rupert Murdoch-owned Wall Street Journal. He brought the friendly of this administration, the editorial board weighing in on the growing view, which
started raining, said he didn't check for the broadcast. That's
the
awesome.
Strategist, loyalist. Bannon,
Maximo was outside taking a nap.
Major policy levels in Afghanistan. And just last week, McMaster said it urged the ousting. Succeeded in the ousting of several Bannon loyalists on the National Security Council. Here's part of what the Wall Street Journal editorial board writes. The former Breitbart publisher has been a White House survivor, but his warring habits have also been responsible for much of the White House dysfunction. Joining me now, two men who know these men.
I ever opened up the store. Sick of this little redhead guy that wrote the book about how Trump won or whatever. Talking about Bannon and all that bullshit. I mean, what did Bannon do? Copy and paste? Oh, no. He copy and pasted the Google Translate. I no longer see CNN or MSNBC. Oh no, there's a CNN. But I don't see all of CNN stories. I don't see any of MSNBC stories show up when they get uploaded on the scroll that says subscription. That's supposed to be all your stuff in order of last upload. Newsy.
Democrats on the House Committee on Oversight and Government Reform have one question. How much money is the federal government spending at President Donald Trump's privately owned businesses? The Democratic committee members sent letters to all 15 cabinet secretaries and leaders of eight other federal agencies to try to find out.
Trump
Each gay. Letter reads in part, the president's financial entanglements make it impossible to know whether he is making his decisions in the public interest or to benefit him or his family members financially. In the letters, committee members cite multiple examples of such federal spending uncovered by the press. Those instances include the president's trips to his Mar-a-Lago resort in Florida, the State Department booking 19 rooms at the Trump Hotel in Vancouver, and Secret Service protection for Eric Trump while he was in Uruguay for business. The committee members are requesting documents on any spending by a department or agency at, quote, businesses owned by or affiliated with the Trump Organization. That request could be challenging since Trump's financial disclosure released in June reported he collects income from or has assets in more than 130 entities. Trump turned management of the Trump Organization over to his eldest sons before taking office. But the president still retains ownership of his company and set up a revocable trust that allows him to withdraw money at any time. The committee Democrats are giving the departments and agencies until August 25th to deliver all relevant documents. More now on North Korea. We want to bring in Newsweek senior writer, former Moscow bureau chief Bill Powell. He's following the latest from Washington. Bill, thank you so much for joining us. I want to ask you first about the latest threats from Pyongyang. Usually the regime's warnings are rather vague, but this one is very specific in regards to Guam. Why is the North targeting this American territory, especially when you consider the U.S. already has other critical, crucial military bases all over the region?
Well, I think it's specifically related to the fact that it is a U.S. territory, and they want to threaten specifically the U.S. as opposed to South Korea or Japan, the U.S. allies in East Asia. And it is, as you said in the opener, it is home to a significant U.S. Military base as well. So the North views it as in that sense, as no doubt a strategic target.
Secretary of State Rex Tillerson played down the heated rhetoric and the overall threat. He says an attack from North Korea is not imminent, and yet we have these intel reports coming out suggesting that Pyongyang can actually fit a miniature nuclear warhead on a missile. Why is this so significant?
Well, the miniaturization issue is critical because it allows the North to put a nuclear bomb on an intercontinental ballistic missile to fit the warhead onto a missile, and therefore presumably.
This guy looks as panicked and nervous as he sounds. I've never seen him before, but former Moscow bureau chief,
we'd be able to deliver that missile. Now, there is. Some skepticism in the intelligence community, both here in the U.S. and among our allies, as to whether they have re-entry capability.
He looks like Cicero.
In their intercontinental missiles, that is to say, whether the missile would break up upon re-entry.
With hair.
Right, the Earth's atmosphere.
Oh, shit. Dip. But that's all, folks. I couldn't pay this, don't worry.
Trump's the most gifted politician of our time, and he's the most orator to hold that office in generations. And so we're going to take the message out to the people. And because you said he is the leader
of this
nationwide and worldwide populist movement, and it's about uplifting working class people, black, Hispanic, white.
They don't want to hear that. And there are certain Republicans who don't want that message to resonate.
That is, of course, White House senior policy advisor Stephen Miller speaking.
He looks like a bottle of suntan lotion that got ran over.
Back to in a second, another poll shows President Trump hitting a new low in job approval. The August
now there is a pleasant thought.
Daily TIPP poll puts his approval rating at 32%, with 59% disapproving. That's a net negative of 27 points. The president's support among Republicans is at 71% in the poll, down 12 points since July, while with white men he's dropped 7 points to 44%. And has 27% support among those who make $30,000 to $50,000 a year. Yet, the president tweeted yesterday, after 200 days, rarely has any administration achieved what we have achieved, not even close. Don't believe the fake news suppression polls. I believe that's a new term. I haven't looked at fake news suppression polls for the president. But Joe, let's go back to Stephen Miller's line there, that this is the greatest orator to hold the office of presidency in generations, which puts Ronald Reagan, perhaps Bill Clinton, even President Obama, in an interesting light.
That really does put him in an interesting light. It is safe to say that he was able to do things, I think, that no other politician has been able to do without an organization, without any hopes. Obviously, he electrified crowds.
Sure.
And he certainly knew how to play to a base, not necessarily a conservative or a Republican base, but a Trump base. But those numbers keep going down, so obviously the tweets, the rallies, all the other things that he's used in the past just aren't as effective as before. And Steve Kornacki, let's look at the worst news, and then look at the parts of this poll, which are just devastating for him, 32%, where he actually is holding a little bit better. The worst news, obviously, is the fall off and the Republican support. He's losing a lot with his Republican base. It's interesting, though, the two areas where he's fallen the least, I saw yesterday, were among white men, -7. And that's since July, so that's still terrible. But also in the Midwest, he's dropped -7, which also was less than all these other subgroups. If he is to pull things together, those are the people that he's got to keep, those white working class men in the Midwest.
Yeah, I mean, look, there's no question whether it's the poll you're looking at right now, or really, I think about a half a dozen polls we've seen over the last 2 weeks, that there's clear slippage now. I mean, this is a president who since his inauguration, and as a candidate all of last year, never lit the world on fire in the general election and as president when it came to his poll numbers. But even by that standard, I think in the last 2 weeks, he's hit a new low. Every poll that's come out in that period has put him in the 30s. We're not even seeing him in the low 40s. The mid-40s, that seems like a long time ago. You've got 3 more right here. So clearly, there's been slippage here. One of the groups in particular, I think when you really dive inside these numbers, where he's struggling, blue-collar white women without a college degree. This is a group. They did very well with last year against Hillary Clinton. There's some talk, some speculation out there that maybe the healthcare news, all of the push for repeal and replace of Obamacare, might have particularly turned them off, might have particularly alienated them. That's one of the theories that out there.
I think if Russian vote hacking targeted anything, it was white women, women in general.
Out there. But I think there's a lot of slippage there. I do think the one thing I always try to keep in my mind when I look at these numbers, though, is that I can remember so many moments in the campaign last year, July, August, September, October, even in the start of November, where we were talking about Donald Trump's slippage, not just with all voters, but with Republican base voters. And I do think there's this element of just almost, I don't know what the term is, but like cultural polarization that exists with Donald Trump, or certainly existed last year in the campaign. And the question I keep asking myself is, when you get back into an election season, does that return?
Well, it may return. It depends on who he's running against. If it's Donald Trump against Bernie Sanders, it returns. If it's Donald Trump against somebody else on the far left, it returns. That's going to be the Democratic Party's challenge. Can they get somebody from Joe Manchin's wing of the party? Can they get a centrist to do it? Can they get a governor from middle America to run? then obviously they've got a shot. But with Willie, it's interesting, you know, people that are driving, and, you know, we hear a lot of people listen to us on the radio. The Gallup poll was around 38%. CBS, I think, was 37%. CNN was 38%.
Yeah.
I know 37 Gallup, 36 CBS, 38 CNN, even the CNN number, that's the lowest Donald Trump's ever scored in that CNN poll.
Yeah, I mean, those are, there's no good way to spin those numbers. And Josh, you live by the polls, you die by the polls. And we all remember Donald Trump did a campaign. His stump speech consisted of pulling a piece of paper out of his jacket pocket and reading the polls and showing how well he was doing. He always has touted the polls because they look good for him during the campaign, not so good now. But what's the practical impact of a president with numbers like that? What does it mean for his ability to get things done?
Well, it means that he's weak and his legislative agenda has failed. His health care bill, which was extraordinarily unpopular, and one reason I think why these numbers are so low, have failed. It's not clear where he's going to move forward. Initially, they were going to do tax reform by the fall. Now maybe it's going to slip in the next year. There's just a general sense that he's not performing as a president or doing anything for anybody. There aren't the kind of tangible accomplishments that would buoy poll numbers among his base voters, among white working class Republicans, and I think that's why you see that slippage across the board. And now this big foreign policy challenge of North Korea front and center right on his plate coming.
Thanks for checking out MSNBC on YouTube, and make sure you subscribe to stay up to date on the day's biggest story.
Joe, joining us now, political reporter for the Washington Post and moderator of Washington Week on PBS, Robert Costa. Bob's taking a look at the new chief of staff in a piece this morning titled, John Kelly is an apolitical force in a White House divided by ideology. Bob, we'll get to that piece in just a second. Do want to ask you, though, because you are so wired into the White House, about the decision, if there was one inside the White House, for President Trump to go out and make his fire and fury comment. Andrea Mitchell just reported pretty extraordinarily that it was not cleared by General Mattis, the defense secretary, who obviously would have to prosecute the fire and fury mentioned by President Trump yesterday. Do you think this was a calculated comment by the president, or was it off the cuff?
Based on my reporting, it was more of an extemporaneous response. The president had notes.
All right, I'll move the camera back.
Team, his foreign policy team. General Kelly, the new chief of staff, has been with him at Bedminster. H.R. McMaster, the national security advisor, has been briefing the president for weeks and months on the North Korean threat. But the president himself is dictating the rhetoric being used, and he's talking to other aides, but it's really the president himself driving the process.
So fire and fury, Bob, was not a line drawn up in a meeting somewhere at Bedminster.
We have no reporting on that yet. The president did have notes.
Joe?
Bob, you obviously have been looking into John Kelly, General Kelly's first week on the job and how he's doing there. It seems to me that there have been some unrealistic views of what this man is supposed to do and what he's not supposed to do. He's never going to be dictating Donald Trump's tweets or telling him what to say in situations like that, is he? He's not, and he can't.
It's not his job.
I'm told by some of his associates that Twitter, and when it comes to public messaging, would not really be his portfolio. He would guide the president when possible, but would it be at the top of his agenda? A chief of staff is managing the staff more than managing the chief.
Right, and as you talk about in your piece, in managing the staff right now, he seems to be able to be a bridge between the different warring factions inside the White House. How long does that last? You know, if it's a Wall Street Journal wrote their editorial this morning, you have Steve Bannon trashing an American hero like General McMaster.
Well, that's an intriguing question, because if you think about Bannon's battle with the General McMaster, it's all about the future of Afghanistan policy, how many troops to have over in the Middle East. And if the president moves in the McMaster direction, in the more traditional AUKUS direction, you could see some outrage from the Bannon wing of the White House, and maybe that could further inflame this situation. I think that if you look at General Kelly, he's also being turned to by a lot of staffers right now to be a voice
a calm on national security to help the president think through the regional challenges when it comes to North Korea. General Kelly has served throughout the world, 45-year Marine. There's hope in the White House and expectation that he can help the president talk through how to work with China, how to work with Japan, and work with international institutions to confront this threat.
Mark Liebrich, it's surreal that you have somebody like Steve Bannon thinking that he can second guess and undercut a Marine general who not only served this country for 45 years all over the world, but lost his son in combat and just said goodbye to another son going over to Afghanistan. I think it's safe to say, unlike Steve Bannon, when it comes to issues like this, the general's all in.
Well, I mean, you would wonder how, I mean, sort of speaking general to general here, what General Kelly thinks. I mean, to me, that relationship between McMaster and Kelly here is sort of central, because you wonder, I mean, when, and if in fact people are blaming Steve Bannon for, you know, the stuff that's been written about McMaster over the last week or so, I mean, does General Kelly take notice? Does General McMaster go to General Kelly and say, you know, what is this? I mean, in so much as there are warring factions in the White House now, it's sort of unclear what that really looks like. I mean, it Bannon seems like he's been sort of in the second wave of sidelining in some ways, in that, you know, apparently, you know, the president was not pleased with this Josh Green book that came out. It gives him more authority. It gives him more of a sense in some ways. That's better.
Well, I mean, Mark, if you read that book, it's basically Steve Bannon got Donald Trump elected president. It was very impressive. But when you have Steve Bannon again trying to dictate policy in Afghanistan, why not just go to your chief of staff that's been all over the world, that's been in the Marines? And as I said, John Kelly just sent his second son over to Afghanistan.
It is very personal, obviously, with military figures, and you do sort of wonder how that relationship is playing out. It's obviously very early in Bob's reporting, sort of speaks to the non-ideological orientation of this. But, you know, you do sort of wonder, where does this go from here? Are they developing a relationship? Is this a candid interaction that he can speak to the president about?
Mark just said, add to something Mark just said, Joe, if you think about the relationship between Bannon and General Kelly. Remember, Bannon's a Navy veteran. Bannon has a daughter who served in West Point, went to West Point. So it's a complicated web within this White House. It's not always easy to figure out who's aligned with who. General Kelly, I'm told, is friendly with Jared Kushner. He's also friendly with Steve Bannon. He's his apolitical figure. So how this all plays out, whether he aligns with the general, perhaps on Afghanistan, but keeps Bannon around to keep the base in check, it's all an open question.
Robert, one of the more interesting dynamics on the White House staff is General Kelly's loyalties. General Kelly has his principal loyalty to this country, our country, and then the President of the United States. In a White House which is somewhat filled with the cult of personality, with this, even though yesterday calling President Trump the greatest orator in the history of the presidency, how is this going down?
Well, let me preface Mike by saying, who knows how this will play out. General Kelly could be short-lived as chief of staff for all I know, but I have a couple of things to say. He told the staff last Friday at a big meeting at the White House, check your opinions at the door. No one really cares about your opinions. Your opinions don't matter. Only the president's opinions matter. Take that into account. And on a big policy decision facing the administration on taxes, at a big meeting last week, he had all these key stakeholders in front of him trying to really sit on the edge of their seats. Where's General Kelly going to lead when it comes to taxes? He said, I don't have a position. My only position on taxes is that I pay them, and I don't like them. And so a lot of people in the White House sat back and said, this new chief of staff is not taking a position. This is a new culture inside of the West Wing. But again, who knows how long it lasts.
It's interesting, Bob, as you said, you weren't sure whether the fire and fury comments were calculated. Obviously not anything that President Trump regrets. He's retweeting right now as we speak from another network stories highlighting his comment about fire and fury. He's retweeted a couple of stories to amplify the message of fire and fury. Bob Costa, always good to talk to you, my friend. Thank you. Coming up, he called.
Thanks for checking out MSNBC on YouTube, and make sure you subscribe.
musket back in May.
Is he still on the tree?
Yeah.
Put two nails right there.
A city worker discovered a man, both hands nailed to a tree. As the officer finally finds him.
What's going on, man?
Still conscious, still breathing. And groaning in pain.
Figure 55, if we can get 55 over here, he's still on the tree.
The officer immediately calls for rescue.
Hey, what happened, man? Paramedics are on their way, okay?
The man refuses to tell the officer his name.
Hey, what's going on, bro? What happened? Do you have an ID on you or something?
But finally gives some details about how he ended up here.
Is there anybody in the area that can still hurt you?
That man, José Durán, spoke to News 13 a few days later. He claims two men were sent that day to threaten and scare him after he was involved in an ugly real estate deal, which he says is all laid out in documents. He took out cameras to the exact same spot where more than...
Real estate. Real.
...a dozen first responders... ...worked for hours...
I didn't realize how bad it was. He said that.
It's never going to get the hell again from the rest of you.
To free him.
I'm going to help you up. On three, over eight.
And when they did, hands grabbed, he walked away, holding on to firefighters. Where's Lucero? Care QE. It's 13.
Glad they found him. That's... not a fun way to go. I don't remember hanging out, but I remember the hand. I remember exactly how that feels. I remember every detail of the metal. And there was a lot of detail to that metal.
Target of an FBI raid. According to the Washington
really?
Post, FBI agents showed up at Paul Manafort's home late last...
Okay, let's see what kind of Kool-Aid the fucking Fox News people are gonna put out.
Last month, seizing documents and other related to the ongoing Russia investigations. This as congressional committees delve deeper. And according to Bloomberg's headline today, demand thousands of documents from the Trump campaign. Joining us now, Hans von Spakovsky, a senior legal fellow at the Heritage Foundation. John Flannery is a former federal prosecutor for the Southern District of New York and former special counsel to the U.S. House and Senate Judiciary Committees. Thanks very much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
John, Paul Manafort says he was cooperating. In fact, he'd been testifying in front of a committee. Why send FBI agents to raid his house when he says he was handing over everything?
Because they obviously didn't think he was, and they convinced the judge that they had reason to search his house for documents, I assume, that they didn't find in the productions made to that date. And I think it was about a month before the search, he had revised his identification as an agent for a foreign government. And the $17.1 million that he got spread over several years from the foreign government appears to have been spread among a Potemkin village of LLCs and corporations. So like every good investigation, you follow the money, and that's what I think they're doing here.
Well, Hans, some might call it, I don't know, witness intimidation.
Well, what I would say is, look, really? There's no reason that the special counsel could not have simply issued a grand jury subpoena. There's no evidence yet been produced that...
Already did. Apparently he failed to meet it.
a search warrant and a raid was necessary, particularly given the cooperation of this particular witness with all these committees.
Particularly?
In Congress. I frankly have
this guy doesn't even look like a real white person.
Oh, I have surgery on my eye, and now I go on Fox News to confuse white people.
Bad suspicion that this is part of Mueller's shock and awe to get back at critics of him and to show them that he may take advantage of the power he's got, particularly with regard to his critics.
Yeah, the threats are entirely...
Real white person. Not a real white person. Real white person. Not a real white person. I'm not racist or anything, but if you're going to be racist, all I'm saying is do it right, you know? See? Real white person. Doesn't like Trump. Not a real white person. Likes Trump. Happens to look like Paul Manafort and all these other fucking people. Real white person, not a real white person. Moron. The end.
There's no evidence of that at all.
There's no reason they couldn't have issued a
trust him to produce what he had. They saved him from spoilation of what they wanted him to do.
They have produced no evidence of any kind. He has not been cooperating with Congress and turning over the documents they've asked for.
Yes, well, this is not about Congress. This is about a grand jury investigation, which they went before a federal district judge, and they convinced him with an affidavit we'd all like to read that explained why they had to do this search under the circumstances.
Congress was working behind the scenes with the FBI. He failed to produce the documents when he went and testified today. So, they stick the FBI on
him. You and I both know that federal prosecutors can convince judges with grand jury subpoenas to get just about anything.
Well, that's not true.
The president has called this a fishing expedition. He says,
yes, well, his whole life.
So he just disparaged the entire legal system and called it corrupt in order to justify Trump's existence.
It's a fishing expedition.
Go ahead.
Well, sending FBI agents in the pre-dawn hours to the home of his former campaign manager. I mean, if there is, there has been no solid proof yet of any Russia collusion.
Yes, there has been. I'm sorry to correct you, but the June 9th, 2016 meeting was exactly collusion, and we can discuss whether it was conspiracy. And among the things they seized, according to one report today, are notes from that...
That's the real white guy speaking.
...meeting that he took that haven't been turned over to anyone, as far as I know. So, it's just not true. And we have the evidence of a cover-up, including about the meeting of June 9th, about a year later with lawyers and everybody, prompting the president to write a note for his son, concealing... aspects of that very meeting. So we certainly have a lot of concern, and the admissions of the president that he fired Comey because of the Russian investigation. So it's not like there's no there. There's plenty of there.
All right. And there is no evidence.
Oh, shut the fuck
whatsoever
up.
Yet of any violation of federal law.
Where do these fucking people go to learn to speak like? Hey, oh god, he talks just like Trump. The Department of Defense Education Activity, DODA, recently sent two high school seniors from Quantico Middle High School, to the Military Child Education Coalition National Training Seminar, or NAMPLA, in D.C. During the event, students sat down with top military officials and asked them a few questions about the military and Baltimore. Why is it important to have schools that are focused on the needs of military-connected children?
Our nation can really pay them back, but it's not so much in terms of money and paycheck. One of our best ways is to ensure that we take care of their soldiers, or take care of their families and their children, and to ensure that they have a good education. That's so fundamental to the future of anybody who's done.
Okay, feel good PR from the DOD. Oh shit.
Пхеньян разрабатывает план нанесения ракетного удара по американскому острову Гуам в Тихом океане, где находится военная база. Об этом заявили в военном командовании КНДР, сообщает государственное агентство ЦТАК. Представитель северокорейской армии подчеркнул, что стратегическое командование рассматривает план удара по Гуаму ракетой «Хвасон-12». Он заверил, что реализовать его можно в любой момент. Заявление было сделано вскоре после того, как президент США Дональд Трамп сказал, что Северной Корее не следует более угрожать США. Они столкнутся с нашим огнем, с нашей яростью и беспрецедентной мощью, отметил он.
So this is a obviously Ukrainian channel, and I think I heard that he agrees with my assessment that those are Russian missile launchers from the Russian army, he said. I'm slowly but steadily, well, not very steadily, but very slowly learning a little bit of Ukrainian. Ukrainsky? Anyway, a bunch of footage of Kim Jong's doing more exercises today, and threatening to hit Guam. Well, they didn't show much of the NGO ship. I'd like to see what kind of people were on board. Maybe they were smugglers. Maybe it wasn't just drugs they were smuggling. Maybe they were smuggling people. Oh, but you can trust this guy because he's got a British accent.
Challenges NGO vessel, Aquarius, in
The Saudi Bin Laden group's got to be sending boats out there scooping up like free people.
Those vigilante groups and global commercial traffic crowding the Western Med. The chances of a more serious incident. Nick Robertson, CNN, London.
This just in, the first lawsuit has now been filed against the president's ban on transgender people serving in any capacity in the U.S. military. Five active duty transgender service members are now suing the administration, asking a federal court to block the ban. It's worth noting here, of course, there's still quite a bit of confusion about the ban, which the president announced in a tweet and caught, from our reporting, caught military leaders off guard. The Pentagon said that it is right now waiting for a directive from the White House before making any changes, but now there's a lawsuit trying to stop any changes from happening in the first place. We'll have much more on that as it comes in. Also this morning, there are new reports of infighting inside the White House and possibly new clues as to who might survive it. The editorial board of the Wall Street Journal taking on the feud between White House Chief Strategy.
Early morning hours, late last month, about 2 weeks ago. This is one day after Jessica Snyder reported, right after Manafort met with that staff of the Senate Intelligence Committee and apparently voluntarily produced some documents to them. So back to our CNN correspondent, Jessica Snyder, who's following this, and also our CNN legal analyst, Danny Ceballos, joins us as well. And Danny, as we noted before the break, it is notable that you can't just execute a search. You need to get a search warrant. And in order to get a search warrant from a judge, you have to show probable cause that a crime was committed.
Exactly. It's constitutional law 101 is in the Constitution. Warrant was search presumptively invalid, unreasonable. A search like this requires a warrant. That means that the FBI had to go to a neutral, detached magistrate, a judge, and describe with particularity what he wanted to search and what he might find there, and connect them, create a nexus to a crime. Now, FBI agents are very, very good at describing these items and getting search warrants, but at their core, they have to convince a judge, ex parte, that means with no other side there, that there is probable cause, more likely than not, that a crime has been committed, and that the things that will be found there will relate to that crime.
Yes, that's notable that the Washington Post said that it was FBI agents working, specifically working with, of course, the special counsel on the Russian investigation, Robert Mueller, that carried out, that executed this raid, and then they left the documents.
Right. So, you know, it's important to note there are several different investigations here operating on several different tracks.
Whenever I hear the word investigator, I think of a reptile with an oculus.
You have the congressional investigation, the Senate Judiciary Committee, and the House and Senate Intelligence Committee. But then, of course, you do have the special counsel's probe as well that's ongoing. And, you know, most focus, or perhaps most focus at this point, is the fact that just a few weeks ago it was disclosed that Paul Manafort did, in fact, meet with that Russian lawyer in that meeting that was initiated in part by him.
Special investigator, a reptile with an oculus and a lisp.
Donald Trump Jr. So, of course, that has become a focus. We know that Paul Manafort did take some handwritten notes. I believe that they've been handed over to at least the congressional committees. So, again, there's renewed focus on Paul Manafort, his role in that meeting, and what else he may have known about that meeting or what he might be able to disclose about that meeting. And, of course, also the timeline is interesting here. This raid, according to the Washington Post, happened on July 26th. This was right as those congressional probes and the hearings were ramping up. It was expected that Paul Manafort might be meeting with the Senate Judiciary Committee on July 26th. Of course, we know that didn't happen. They decided not to issue a subpoena for Paul Manafort because he agreed to more fully cooperate with them. So yes, Paul Manafort, we know, according to his spokesman, has been cooperating with the congressional committee. But the question is, special counsel Mueller's probe. That is
it's a stall tactic.
Focuses, so they might not be getting exactly what they want. That's why this raid is necessary. It's an important note. Look, I mean, you even had the Republican chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee, Chuck Grassley, Jessica, saying we're going to compel him to testify in public, subpoena him if he does not cooperate more. And then, of course, they got some agreement. Came out of the story, and then the raid happened. Thank you, Jessica. Standing to all the street case police life for always. Ahead for us, President's strong language against North Korea, facing some backlash from some on both sides of the aisle. But new comments like his helped him
take your allergy pills.
Warning a fresh attack on the president's key strategist, Steve Bannon, and from an unexpected place, the Rupert Murdoch-owned Wall Street Journal. He was assembly to this administration, the editorial board weighing in on the growing feud between Trump's national security advisor, H.R. McMaster, strategist, loyalist, Steve Bannon, the two reportedly sparred over major policies like troop levels in Afghanistan. And just last week, McMaster said it urged the ousting and succeeded in the ousting of several Bannon loyalists on the National Security Council, which is part of what the Wall Street Journal editorial board writes. The former Breitbart publisher has been a White House survivor, but his warring habits have also been responsible for much of the White House dysfunction. Joining me now, two men who know these men quite well, Josh Green, national correspondent at Bloomberg Business Week, and author of the now very well-known Devil's Bargain, Steve Bannon, Donald Trump, and the forming of the presidency, and Thomas Rick, and your Pulitzer Prize winning writer, former reporter for the Wall Street Journal, and the Washington Post, and the author of Churchill and Orwell, The Fight for Freedom. Quite the bios, my friends. Thank you for both being here. Let me go to you first, Josh. I mean, the Journal editorial board has sometimes, because there were two or three critical opinion pieces about this president. But definitely pretty friendly. This is something that Rupert Murdoch would have had to sign off on, right?
Absolutely. And I think the cause of Journal's concern is that Bannon, unlike McMaster and Trump's other advisors, has almost an isolated view of American foreign policy. Even though Bannon doesn't have the kind of national security credentials you'd expect from somebody who wants the National Security Council, he has a very clear idea of how he thinks America should behave abroad, and it's different than other people in the White House think. It's different than the view generally put forward by the Wall Street Journal editorial board.
Sure, that's a good point. Tom, you wrote an article that got quite a lot of attention in May, basically arguing McMaster is too good for this White House, and that you thought he was good around the president because he would make the president be stronger, better, more reliable. You changed that opinion this spring. Your thoughts on this is McMaster battles basically an opponent within the West.
Yeah, my view now that we should just let Trump, those people around him, think they're incompetent. The rest of you have government just shot the law. It's a pretty robust government. In the White House itself, I think that all people like McMaster do make Trump more effective. And I think that's bad. We don't want effective Trump because he's erratic and dangerous. I think when McMaster looks at Trump, he must think to himself, this is totally outside my army experience. All I can think when he looks at, when McMaster looks at Bannon, he thinks this is like dealing with the Islamic extremists in Iraq.
Think that?
I think so. He's trying to fathom, who is this guy? Where did he come from? What does he want? And McMaster did work effectively with Islamic extremists in Iraq. So I brought some over to his side. I think he's probably been trying to
it was his policy and his ideas that really led to the surge back in 2007. But Josh, you talked about this, you were interviewed about this, and one of the things you said, he said Bannon is the authentic connection to and representation of Trump's base politics. He went on to say the one thing that Trump fears most in the world is losing that connection and losing that support to his base. Does that mean that if it were to come, Bannon versus Bannon wins?
Well, I don't know. I think that's a question that may be headed toward finding an answer to, but I think that Bannon believes
If you just look at some of these headlines that we pulled together from Breitbart, which of course he then founded, we used to run, and still has connections to obviously to the people that work there, they are scathing against McMaster. Center for Security Policy calls for HR McMaster discrimination, that's one. Report HR McMaster increasingly volatile and, quote, frequently blows to the top. Third headline, NSC, National Security Council, purged McMaster, deeply hostile to Israel and Trump. Do you think it will work? Do you think he will survive the West Wing long term?
I think it will work in the sense that if it comes down to Trump having to make a choice, Bannon McMaster, I think he'll go with Bannon, because Bannon knows, he knows better. Bannon knows how to flatter him. McMaster has tried to flatter Trump, but he's not good at it. He doesn't sound sincere when he's under. So I think McMaster's days are probably numbered.
If that is the case, Josh, what does that mean for Americans watching and thinking, look, these are two men that greatly shape U.S. policy, that greatly influence the president, for example, on are we going to send more troops into Afghanistan? This is critically important.
Well, it's not clear to me that Trump is listening to Bannon. I mean, McMaster's has been far more hawkish toward North Korea. I think McMaster's has succeeded with help from the new chief of staff, General Kelly, in pushing out Bannon loyalists from the NSC. So while Bannon is a very important figure in Trump's universe from a domestic political standpoint, in terms of his connection to Trump's populist base, I'm not sure that Trump is as willing to go along with Bannon on foreign policy. And I think the fact that that's still an open question is why you have this open media war now between the Wall Street Journal on one side, Breitbart News on the other side.
Yeah, it is fascinating to see. Thank you very much, Josh. Congratulations on the book as well. Thomas Ricketts, so nice to have you. Thank you. He was a star behind the microphone and in front of the camera, meant so much to
speak. I would love to.
One month ago, Congressman Dan Kilby of Michigan was in South Korea at the same time that the North Korean regime was testing another missile. He was there speaking to U.S. military and South Korean officials. He's here with me now. Thank you for joining me, Congressman. Look, you were on the peninsula during one of these tests. You have a unique perspective. You're home now with your constituents. Rex Tillerson, Secretary of State, his comments this morning were Americans should sleep well at night. Are your constituents sleeping well, given what has transpired in the last 24 hours?
Well, I think they are, but there's obviously a growing concern, and that concern is fueled when the President of the United States deliberately uses language that escalates sort of the war of words, and I think, unfortunately, matches the tone and tenor of North Korean officials. This is the United States of America. We ought not engage in sort of belligerent talk. When I talk to my constituents, they know that the U.S. will go to these protected citizens. There are some concerns about the president, whether his choice of words is really thoughtful and helpful.
I hear that. And look, there have been others, Republicans, John McCain among them, who are critical of the language. Given that, there have been preceding presidents, Democrats and Republicans, language has been much more tempered, much more measured. The counterargument to yours is that that's not work, that's not deterred this
regime. Well, the point, though, is that that doesn't mean that belligerent language is a step in the right direction. A step in the right direction, I think, perhaps, would be to really put pressure, for example, on China. I mean, is the president willing to be tough in his private conversation with Chinese officials, get them to take the steps necessary to actually reel in North Korea, to actually...
All right, well, they got China on board with the U.S. sanctions.
So that was
and we have sanctioned one big Chinese bank. So what else do you think would actually be effective in moving Xi Jinping's hand?
I think the president needs to make it clear that China needs to be willing to end trade.
Completely.
Well, this is the one piece of leverage that we have that does not escalate the potential for military action. It's very clear that China, in some ways, wants to be able to have it both ways. They vote with us at the Security Council. We can't say that's a bad thing. That's a step in the right direction. And they are willing to help sanction, in a limited sense. But unless they're willing, unless they're actually willing to take a bold step and say, we're going to cut off trade with North Korea, that's essential for
economy is not exactly flourishing right now, as you know. I mean, this is a regime, this is an economy that is already on the brink, but you are convinced that cutting them off economically from the rather robust trade agreement they still do have with China would be sufficient, would actually turn the tide.
It would make a difference, because those who are right around, those sort of wealthier members of North Korean society, that very small percentage of the population in Pyongyang, they would feel it. And that's what we need to do. We need to put a squeeze on those few people who can have any effect on
quickly before you go, we have 30 seconds left, but your fellow Democratic Congressman Ted Lieu and Senator Ed Markey have proposed this legislation that would bar the president without congressional approval, any president, and they, as Congressman Lieu told me yesterday, proposed this also before Trump was president, to get congressional approval for first use of their weapons. Would you support that? Because this is power that any U.S. president has had since 1946.
It is power that the U.S. president has, Congress has its authority. Well, and this is a case where we know that the threat is existent. We know that the president does make potential use of the force. This is not a moment when the president, in the heat of an exigency, would. This is a conversation that needs to take place. The authority of Congress should be asserted, and particularly in the case of the president, where he seems to be somewhat erratic when it comes to what he suggests as American foreign policy.
Congressman Dan Kilby of Michigan, thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Blame Bannon, the Wall Street Journal editorial board this morning said yes, slamming the president's chief strategist and his backers for creating what it calls, quote, White House dysfunction and fueling the fume with National Security Advisor H.R. McMaster.
Political comedy has become a part of.
Good morning, everyone. Top of the hour. I'm talking to Carlos John Berman in off this week. The president threatening fire and fury. The Secretary of State, though, saying this morning Americans should sleep well and rest assured. We begin with some reassuring words from Tillerson after the single most chilling public statement made by the U.S. president in quite a while aimed at North Korea, and you will hear that in a moment. First, Tillerson's comments a short time ago on a flight from Malaysia to Guam.
I think Americans should sleep well at night. I have no concerns about this particular rhetoric of the last few days. I think the president, again, as commander in chief, I think he felt it necessary to issue a very strong statement directly to North Korea. But I think what the president was just reaffirming is the United States has the capability to fully defend itself from any attack that would offend our allies, and we will do so. So the American people should sleep well
tonight. That is what Tillerson said. Let's contrast that with what we heard from President Trump yesterday.
North Korea does not make anyone threats in the United States. They will be met with fire and fury like the world has never seen.
President's statement on the U.S. nuclear arsenal. For its part, Pyongyang is threatening potentially to hit the U.S. territory of Guam. And adding to the cluster, a new U.S. intelligence assessment, that North Korea likely does have and has developed nuclear weapons small enough to fit atop long-range missiles and miniaturized weapons, which is important to note. Those CNN reporting is that they've not been tested yet. Americans are certainly paying attention. A brand new CNN poll shows 62% of Americans consider North Korea a very serious threat to the United States. That is up from 48% in March. Half of Americans, interestingly, think the United States should take military action in response to these North Korean nuclear missile tests. This would be as opposed to 43% now. We're covering all of these developments across the globe. Let's begin with our Will Ripley, who joins us from Beijing and who has been to Pyongyang more than a dozen times. Will, what do you make of all of this?
Well, there's a lot to unpack, Poppy. Certainly around the region, there are a number of things that have countries, including China, where I am right now, caused alarm. There is growing fear in this region that there could really be an accidental war on the Korean Peninsula. It seems as if all of the stakeholders involved don't want this war to break out. But the concern is that the fiery rhetoric, unpredictable behavior, that one action to a chain reaction from which there is no coming back. last couple of hours. A statement from the Chinese government was often tries to call for calm when tensions bubble up on the Korean Peninsula. The Ministry of Foreign Affairs saying, quote, China calls on the relevant sides. First saying the current situation on the Korean Peninsula is complex, sensitive. China calls on the relevant sides to follow the broad direction of resolving the nuclear issue through political means. Avoid remarks and actions that can aggravate conflicts and escalate tensions. That's the key word right there. And make a greater effort to return to the correct path of resolving the issue, dialogue, and negotiation. So China asking the United States to refrain from fiery rhetoric, also asking North Korea to refrain, because it was North Korea that really shocked many in the world by threatening perhaps a direct military strike on U.S. military assets in Guam using their intermediate-range missiles, which they were really testing at a frenzied pace for much of last year. Now they're focusing on their ICBM. They have a lot of other missiles in the arsenal as well. Whether they would actually accurately strike the target is a different story that is up for discussion. A lot of analysts weighing in on that. Other reactions from around the region, you have most U.S. allies saying that they believe North Korea is a threat to security, trying to avoid direct criticism of President Trump for his remarks.
The pattern of testing hasn't been that of development. It's been that of demo. Look what Uncle Putin said.
Well, let me just get your session, because you have spent so much time in the region and had this rare contact with officials in the North Korean regime. I mean, how do they look at this, do you believe? Is this about developing this capability and then hoping to use it, or is this about developing the capability to protect
peace? I was in North Korea about a month and a half ago talking about this with government officials there, and we spoke repeatedly about it over the last couple of years. North Korea has it written in their constitution that they want to become a full-fledged nuclear power. They want to have an intercontinental ballistic missile. They want to have a full range of missiles that they view really as a deterrent. The goal of possessing these weapons is not to have them so they can use them, but to keep the regime led by Kim Jong-un in power. That is their number one priority. They want to. They basically want mutually assured destruction. They want the world to believe that if anyone tries to military action against North Korea, they can do so much damage. They can destroy large portions of South Korea. They can potentially target Japan. They can target Guam. And with this ICBM, they can also send a very dramatic message. They can potentially strike much of the mainland United States with a nuclear weapon. And so it's about leverage. It's also about respect. And it's about when there are discussions, being able to have those discussions on North Korea's own terms without concession of what the United States has been insisting on for.
Ripley, thank you for your expertise and reporting this morning for us. We appreciate it. Also this morning, the president writing, first order was to renovate and modernize our nuclear arsenal. He went on to say it is now far stronger and more powerful than ever before. The president also adding, there will never be a time we are not the most powerful nation in the world. Let's go to the Pentagon and bring in our Barbara Starr. Now, Barbara, I think it's important to point out in terms of this new capability
really?
That we know of, or at least miniaturization of this weaponry. It's not a consensus agreement across all U.S. intelligence that this is where North Korea stands right now, correct?
That's right, Poppy. There is an assessment, you know, but that's what it is, an assessment, not a hard fact, because you really have no way of absolutely knowing it. There is a full agreement. What some of the intelligence community have assessed is that North Korea has produced, and that's a key word, produced, a miniaturized nuclear warhead that could go on a missile. But look, the North Koreans do have their own challenges ahead of them. Would that warhead, has it ever been tested? They don't think the U.S. doesn't think so. Could it go on the front end of a missile? Could you fire that missile with a warhead? Could it survive re-entry into the Earth's atmosphere? Do the North Koreans have the kind of precision targeting needed for the credible threat of striking a particular point, whether it's Guam or Japan or South Korea? They can fire the missiles. We've seen it time and again. Not, you know, and it's not clear that they have that precision target. They fired into the ocean and it lands where it lands. So can they take really the next step, do this precision targeting and carry out such an attack? A lot of big time rhetoric from the North Korean regime. Very hot, fiery rhetoric. Hot, fiery rhetoric back from President Trump. All of it with the reality check. indicating that the U.S. nuclear arsenal is more powerful since he came into office? Maybe a reality check on that, because much of what happens in the U.S. nuclear arsenal is heavily regulated by international treaties.
Commissar, depending on, thank you for your reporting, as always, let's take you now to Seoul, South Korea. Leaders there this morning calling for a complete overhaul of their military defense. Alexander Field is live for us. What else are you hearing, given obviously the proximity to the regime?
Yeah, Poppy, this is a really tough needle to thread for leaders here because they want to tame tensions and they also want to protect their people against the possibility of a misstep that could lead to conflict here. That's the risk when you wage a war of words really all across the globe. So leaders in this part of the world have been calling for calm. At the same time, these are the words that came from South Korea's dovish president, the man who was elected to power just a few months ago, advocating for greater dialogue with North Korea. Here's what he said today.
Sounds and looks like an RTA.
Military. It should be an intensive one. I believe we need a complete overhaul instead of defense reform at a level of a minor improvements or modifications. To put that into context, these are words that he spoke at a ceremony. He sent these words to military commanders. These were not a direct response to the ratcheting up of rhetoric that we have seen from both South Korea and the U.S., but this is certainly a realization of the intensity of the situation that has unfolded on the peninsula and the security threat that South Korea very much feels they're under. They've lived under a threat for decades. It has certainly reached its highest level. When you talk about the fact that North Korea has shown that they can test these ICBMs, they may have the capacity to miniaturize a nuclear weapon. Look, North Korea doesn't need to use nukes. They don't need to use ICBMs to launch an attack right here in the region. They can use conventional weapons that are just on the other side of the DNC. And should they be provoked somehow, even if by mistake to do that, the South Korean government, of course, sees it as their responsibility to be ready as best they can be.
Alexander Field, of course, well, thank you very, very much. And I do want to go now to Joe Johns, our senior Washington correspondent. He's in Bedminster right now, where the president is right now on this working vacation. And Joe, you've got some new numbers out quickly to tell us how Americans are feeling in all of this.
That's right, Poppy. The president has no public events on his schedule today, and staff did not explicitly say he's going to receive his intelligence briefing. However, he has received it every day this week. The latest developments come at a time when the public seems to be expressing some skepticism about the president's handling of issues related to North Korea. That is SRS poll conducted for CNN. A number of questions. Let's just go into the graphic. When asked about Mr. Trump's handling of the North Korea situation, 37% said they approve, 50% said they disapprove, 13% not sure. When asked about whether they favor military action in response to North Korea's weapons testing, 3/4 of Republicans approve, about half of independents, about a third of Democrats. And when asked about the comparative threats to the United States, ISIS and North Korea have just about top billing, with almost the same amount of concern, 64% to 62%. So that is American public opinion, at least right now, on North Korea by the numbers. I'll be back to you.
So, John, thank you very much.
Russia wasn't there.
More perspective on all of this. Joining me now, CNN military analyst and retired Air Force Colonel Cedric Layton, and fellow and free chair of the Center for Strategic International Studies, Lisa Collins. It is nice to have you both here. Colonel, let me begin with you. It's a very different message within a 24-hour span of time from the president, the words he chose to use yesterday, and what Rex Tillerson, the Secretary of State, said this morning as he was flying to Guam and was urging Americans to sleep well at night. You know, you should not be in fear right now. He's the one who has been pushing for weeks for what he's calling peaceful pressure, saying they're not looking for regime change, willing to sit down at the table with North Korea. Is the president undercutting the Secretary of State?
Well, Poppy, I would say that the answer is yes, it probably was unintentional, but it really makes it much more difficult for Secretary of State Tillerson to do his job. One of the key things that I think the Secretary was trying to do in his statements there about sleeping well at night was really to try to reassure people that he had things under control and was working toward a peaceful resolution of this issue. But I think this is an area where we need to be very cautious, very vigilant, and it's going to be a time with a lot of danger in it, I believe.
I said to you the assessment from some Republicans in Congress. You have John McCain, know, basically quoting Teddy Roosevelt saying, you know, carry a big stick but walk softly, right? And saying, you don't say things unless you're ready to act, and questioning whether the president's ready to act. And then you have Daryl Issa making this equivalent to saying we haven't seen anything undoubtedly like this since the Cuban Missile Crisis. Are those, do you think, correct assessments at this hour?
Well, I think that we are not on the brink of war with Korea, although the tensions are very high. North Korea has been working on the technology to develop a nuclear tip for continental ballistic missile for many years. So I think that they are very rapidly developing this technology. And we see that through the continual testing that they've conducted over the last few years. And I think this new assessment that came out just yesterday is definitely somewhat troublesome, but I don't think it's new to those who are watching the situation very carefully.
And they said, I want to qualify that. Just ask you, is it important to note that U.S. intelligence before had overestimated North Korea's capability and speed? If you look at 2000, if you look under President Bush, there was an assessment that the regime was very close to developing the technology in ICBM, and they informed at that time. Something markedly different now, or is there a lesson to be learned from that?
I don't think things are markedly different now. There has always been a difference of opinion in terms of experts thinking about how fast North Korea is developing its technologies. I think that there are still experts who believe that North Korea doesn't have the important technology for reentry of a nuclear tipped missile. And there are also some questions about whether or not the guidance system, which would accurately target a city, would actually work. So I think there are still variances within the expert community about how advanced North Korea's nuclear program actually is, but I think it's important that we not underestimate them because they are not afraid of failures and they continually test, and each test that they conduct, they learn something new. And I think that they're very rapidly escalating and advancing in their technology.
Charles, to you, the people around the president, especially his new chief of staff, General Kelly, H.R. McMaster, you know, General Mattis, et cetera, do you think that they would have signed off on the president using the words that he used yesterday, the fire and fury rhetoric?
I don't think so, Poppy. I think they would have preferred much more measured language. And I think there's also a time and no place. Sometimes language like the president used yesterday is very appropriate, but it's usually done when there is a situation that has actually happened or we know is about to happen at this juncture for the word of the president to use. Type of rhetoric that he used is the idea of fire, the idea of using all means of national power against North Korea. All of that is certainly true in the event of hostilities, but it's perhaps an unnecessary reminder at this juncture that would be the consequence of any type of action that North Koreans would engage in that would be a hostile action, especially against mainland U.S. or U.S. territories like Guam.
Colonel Layton, thank you, Lisa Collins. We appreciate your expertise. A lot ahead. The words of the president like the world has never seen. That is a phrase, of course, he used yesterday regarding North Korea, but as we've seen, it's a repeated phrase that he uses often in different situations as well. Hey, good morning, everyone. Welcome to your new day. It is Wednesday, August 9th, 8 o'clock. Please, Chris is off the morning. Gilbert joins me. We've already had a lot of breaking.
Is it like this every morning?
Yeah, pretty much.
Existential.
Yes.
Breaking news.
A little bit. This seems to be a bit of a different category today, but we're glad you're here. If we start with breaking news this hour. Secretary of State Rex Tillerson makes this surprise visit to Guam. He said President Trump is sending a strong message to North Korea, warning that any threat to the U.S. would be met with, quote, fire and fury. Secretary Tillerson also trying to reassure Americans about this threat.
His words come after North Korea threatened to attack Guam, USS Air Force Base. Since after bombers flew over the Korean Peninsula, the Pacific region is watching this escalating situation closely. China warning against worsening tensions. We have the global resources in it covering every angle we can in China. Beijing, specifically with Will Ripley, has traveled inside North Korea more than a dozen times and has the very latest on the Secretary of State's visit to the Pacific. Well,
still, these words from Secretary Tillerson perhaps are exactly what Chinese government officials wanted to hear. They, within the last hour, have been calling for calm here, as they often do when tensions escalate on the Korean Peninsula. Secretary Tillerson trying to reassure Americans that they do not face an imminent threat for North Korea, also saying he does not believe Guam faces
off from Guam. Secretary Tillerson will try to ease the tensions and smooth over the situation, also defending the fiery rhetoric of President Trump.
I think the president, what the president is, sending a strong message to North Korea in language that Kim Jong-un would understand, because he doesn't seem to understand diplomatic language. I think the president just wanted to be clear to the North Korean regime that the U.S., you know, unquestionable ability to defend itself, well defend itself and its allies. And I think it was important that he delivered that message, avoiding miscalculation on their part.
Any analyst believes that North Korea really presents the greatest threat. If they feel like they're cornered, that's when they can lash out. Secretary Tillerson saying he doesn't know if they've backed North Korea into a corner, also saying he doesn't want anybody to be backed into a corner where they don't feel they have a way out. He's stressing diplomacy here, which is what China is calling for as well. In a brand new statement just released to CNN within the last hour after we sent them a question about President Trump's remarks and the North Korean threats, China saying, quote, current situation on the Korean Peninsula is complex and sensitive. China calls on the relevant sides to follow the broad direction of resolving the nuclear issue. Political means avoid remarks and actions that could aggravate conflict and escalate tensions and make a greater effort to return to the correct path of resolving the issue through dialogue and negotiations. China also pledged their part to enforce this latest round of UN sanctions unanimously approved. China cut North Korean exports by a third, about $1 billion. Which the hope is that that will slow the regime's ability to pay for their rapidly advancing missile program.
Well, we've been mentioning this morning, thanks to you, President Trump's unprecedented warning to North Korea, unleashing fire and fury, could undermine diplomatic efforts to defuse the situation. That's the belief of some lawmakers on both sides of the island. Moments ago, the president.
All right, folks, it doesn't appear to me like we're going to have a response just yet because it's thundering outside. I fell asleep on the couch, and it started raining. Real life person, big life person, moron. I tried. What's up, Carlos? It doesn't seem like they laid eggs. I just realized, I didn't notice last time, so it's best if I double check the pot, right? But they didn't lay any eggs. If I see them starting to spawn later, I will start the live stream. I'm going to leave everything set up. And I'm going to go ahead and call it a broadcast for now. I'm tired. Work to do, which happy does here. Anyway, thanks for watching. Y'all click the like button and make sure you subscribe and with the little dingy bell button thing. The bell there, little bell. Ding 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 ding. So you get notifications about when I do my thing. Y'all take it easy.